All right, we're going to shift now to do the intra-articular approach, which will do a lacrimal osteotomy to do this approach. Oh, okay, next. So the indication is to have a proper exposure for the intra-articular surface of the distal humerus. So if you have a comminution or multi-fragmentary fracture in the distal humerus, so you have to reflect the triceps mechanism by doing lacrimal osteotomy. Next. So usually it depends about the position. Either you put the patient in prone or lateral with arm support with exposure for the posterior surface of the arm and the forearm. So we have the classical posterior incision. I think all of you did it with the posterior. So you're going to continue this with the forearm. So you do some curvature with the radial side. But you need, I think the radial side is better than the medial side because you need to mark the ulnar nerve. So one trick which is I learned when I did my fellowship, always when you put the patient prone, mark the ulnar side because you're gonna be confused about where is the medial and where the lateral. So always mark the ulnar side. So this is where you need to identify the nerve. So next, please. And this is when you do skin, then subcutaneous tissue, you need to identify the nerve, which is always you start with the vital structure, then you need to release the lateral side. Next, please. Here, this is the technical point about, this is the ulnar. I will distribute this ulnar bone to make sure that you see the small bare area of the ulnar side, which you need your cut to be in this side. I will show this in the bone. Actually, let's put the next, please. So you can see this is where you need your cut to be there. There is a small bare area which you need to cut to exit in this area. And you need to be in your saw perpendicular to this area, because if it's angled saw, you're gonna either exit below or above this area. So next, please. So we will do a chevron osteotomy. Why we prefer this? Because this will increase the surface area for the bone healing. And also this will give a little bit more stability for even a rotation when you do reduction for the electron. Next, please. Next. Next. So this is, you're gonna start with the oscillating saw. Then next, you're gonna finish with a manual saw, because you're gonna reach the subchondral bone with the oscillating saw. Then you're gonna finish this with the regular saw. Sometimes, because it's, you can see there is an identification, there is a ridge in the trochlear notch, you can see here. Sometimes you're gonna use a small one because you need this with a uniform surface when you do your cut. Next. All right, so let's do the demonstration here. Okay, after doing the skin incision, and you need to do a proper release. So I'm a little bit here confused where the medial side and lateral side, but we can see that there is the radial head here, so that's why I'm always thinking about the marking. And this is the medial side, this is the radial side. So we're gonna release the soft tissue from the ulnar side. So we identify the nerve, as we can see here. Then we retract the nerve, then identify, expose the bone all the way in the medial side. Then go to the lateral side. We can expose the proximal part, actually, of the anconius, as you can see here, to be flush to the bone. Okay, there is some trick actually mentioned, that Dr. Cameron mentioned in his lecture, that when you put a tape or inside the intra-articular side of the trochlear notch, and this is what exactly here, you can see when you put a tape around this and you can bring it forward and backward, the tape, it will settle exactly where is your cut go. So when you put a tape and go, bring it forward and backward, it will be exactly here. So this is, you can mark your cut exactly where you need. So we don't want a small piece of olecranon. We don't want a bigger piece of olecranon. We need a proper size. So we do this, and it's set it down. So we mark it this with a marker. Then we start with doing our... I need the tip to be in our exit. So this is the tip. So I will do my angle here. Then I'll finish my osteotomy with the osteotome. So I need to be perpendicular. I will not do like this. I will not do like this. So it's done. So that's why it's mentioned to put a small osteotome in the middle, so it will not... It's almost done, right? Okay, so actually, you can see after that, can I have a knife, please? So you can see that it's a little bit proximal, but... Okay. So you can see that where is my tape? You can see it's here. So I'm a little bit like a few millimeter proximal the tape. So this is exactly what you need to have. So this is a little bit proximal. But when you do your cut, please try to see exactly where you need to go, which is exactly in the bare area in this side. All right? So please start. You have 10 minutes for this one? Okay. Less than 10 minutes. Okay. All right, so actually type of fixation, either you do K-wire tension band or you can put a plate. So there is a plate in your table, so you can just put that plate and see how it's fit on the olecranon.
This is the wrong plate because it's angled.
Yes. So we have right and left, so it depends about your cadavers. If it's right or left, it will fit properly. Thank you.
About implants used in distal humeral fixation. Excuse me, please. As in the lecture of Dr. Abd Hakim in the first day, we discussed the principle of having both plates at the 90 degrees to each other. And this was changed a little bit to 180 fixation, the two plates opposite, one on each side of the humerus. One on each, yes. The first we discussed about the perpendicular plates, having two plates perpendicular to each other, and then having two plates on the same plane, parallel to each other. And then with the evolution of plates, the column plate appeared, which with a posterolateral one and a medial one. And also there was the long plate that solves the idea that if you put a fixation in the distal humerus with a long plate, you find it as you go proximal, the plate, and you have holes that are not going to having screws through the bone. The plate is going into very medial part. And this is how it looks in the X-rays. Very good implant, but it's not, and you are not familiar with it here. Then the evoluted, the recent plate, you will have a model of it on your table. We'll have, this is the lateral column plate, is a 3.5 millimeter plate for the proximal part and 2.7 locked plates. And then this even was, this is was an fixed, yani locked fixed screws, and it changed into a variable angle screws. You can direct the distal screws to 15 or 30 degrees in each direction with to take the maximum purchase in the fractured bone. You'll find it on your table. You can have a look at it and get some sort of familiar with it. Thank you very much.